My name is Bill O'Neill. I'm professor of clarinet at UTRGV, and I'm your clinician here today to help you in your preparations for region band auditions in November. You will have one of three reactions to things that I tell you today, and your first reaction is, I knew that. And it's okay for me to tell you that you're right. In fact, sometimes it's kind of nice to hear from an authority figure. The second reaction will be, that's great, why didn't I think of it? In which case you probably would have sooner or later, because over the past 15, 16, 17, 18 years, you've heard a lot of music. And more recently, you've made quite a bit of music, and you've formed a body of knowledge about music that kind of hangs together and makes sense for you, which is probably about 90% right, maybe more. And so when you have that, wow, of course reaction, it fits in there with things that you already know, makes your picture of music a little more complete. And very often what's happened is there are two bits of information that you had not thought of connecting, and until that moment, and then they get connected, it's electric. And your progress goes right off the graph for the next month or two until you use the idea up, and then hopefully we don't do this, and hopefully we don't do this. More likely we do this. And the dramatic progress becomes good progress for the next little while until the next moment. Thrilling when those things happen, and they do. Your third reaction will be, huh? And you'll look at me like I've lost my mind. Doesn't mean the information is wrong, it's just outside of that body of knowledge. And any time that you become anybody's student of anything, whether it's for 4 years or 25 minutes or whatever, the first thing you're admitting is that you still have something to learn. And it's okay for me to say that, since I still have something to learn. So those are the three reactions that you will have. Now, I want to go through some routine things, just clarinet things, before we get to the specifics of the etudes. Qualities of great clarinetists. And the first is great tone. Great tone is strong at all dynamic levels, and it's not droopy. No, I don't think you want to sound like that. And then if we, the adjudicators, if can't hear you, you won't impress them, us. You won't impress your audience. If the sound is weak, if you play timidly, you're not going to really communicate the music very well. They'll be watching you play, perhaps, and kind of, okay. We don't want that. We want to grab people's attention and hold it. And for that, we need a strong sound, which is not automatically a loud sound. You need a good mouthpiece. The rest of the instrument is important, but your tone is in the mouthpiece, and it's what you do with it. Reeds have an impact on it, but without a good mouthpiece, the best reeds in the world are not going to sound good. The best clarinets in the world are not going to sound good. So we make sure that we have one, and one way to try that, to determine that, is to try out a whole bunch of mouthpieces. If we have a live TMEA this year, maybe you go and you try out 65 mouthpieces over three or four different dealers, and you find the one that you like the best, and you find that it's $175, which is the discounted price, and you say, well, it's worth it, I hope. All your equipment has to be in good condition. If you have leaky pads because you haven't taken it into the shop, you say, I'll do that soon. Everything from that point down is fuzzy and weak and has more squeak potential. None of that is desirable. There are four variables in tone production. The first is the degree of tip openness of the mouthpiece. So we have anywhere from quite a close facing to very, very open. And the more open it is, the farther the reed has to flap to do the job. And so a very strong reed on a very open mouthpiece is not a good combination. You have to use incredible amounts of wind and bite in order to get this thing to work. If you use a lighter reed on an open-faced mouthpiece, it will flap far enough and do the job well for you. And so that's a good balance. If you have a closer facing, which is not unusual, with the weak reed, then it goes, and where does the wind go? Right there. Or you just, you're fighting the instrument all the time, which isn't much fun. But a stronger reed on a closer facing is a good balance. Okay, so four variables, which I, by the way, a number 1 through 5. So that's one and two. The third is how big a chomp do you take at the tip of the mouthpiece? So if it's a little tiny one, that reed is thin, no matter how strong it is. That reed is thin at that point. And so any pressure at all, you go, yep. And that's what we just talked about a moment ago. If you take a little larger, the reed is thicker. More spring to it, less likely to get jammed into that space and shut down the tip. Take a little bit larger, take a little bit larger, take a little bit larger, until you find that the tone, you're starting to lose ground. Your tone is spreading and you're kind of squeak prone, so then you back off. And you learn to play with that size of bite where your tone is the richest, most resonant. Size of bite, strength of bite. You could still overpower the reed, but your lip might be bleeding very quickly. The fifth variable, out of four, I'll have to show you this one. The higher I moved the clarinet, the more the position of my teeth on the underside of the reed changed closer to the tip, and it tends to shut down the tip until it did. And you heard that happening. The sound got weak and thin and disappeared, and I brought it down and started to speak again, and then it filled out and filled out and filled out and filled out. Again, you want to find with whatever position your jaw happens to be in, whatever the orthodontist might have done to you, you want to find the angle that you can be comfortable that will allow you to get the best possible tone, and it won't be quite the same for everybody. A suggestion, play sharper. Get a tuner out, do some warm-ups. Play sharper and then tune down. A firm bite and good upward pressure from the right thumb. We don't want the clarinet feeling like it's going to roll off your thumb, and so then you have to do all kinds of extra things like some of us had to do in middle school to help hold the instrument because you're afraid you're going to lose it. So, okay, great technique. All your equipment has to be in good condition, so that's important for tone and for technique. Good, consistent position. We want to keep our fingers near work, and we want to keep them curved. If any of you play piano and have had lessons, your piano teacher is not going to let you play with fingers that collapse like that, because you can't possibly lift them as short a distance as under control. Same thing on the clarinet. So we want to learn to play with curved fingers. That's kind of tough because most of us were little when we started playing. And so we did survival playing. And then we have to correct that. And today is the first day of the rest of your life kind of thing. If you can start fixing that now, you will love the results, but the process is annoying. In great technique, you practice the hardest spots first and the most. Dr. Seal, our late colleague here, taught double reeds in orchestra. Used to say, start with the blackest spots on the page. We'll talk about that in a moment. But start with the blackest, the hardest spots, and work outward. And that's a good practice procedure. You don't always feel so good about yourself, but you learn things very quickly because you didn't need to practice those whole notes. Other than counting, they work for you right from the get-go. Use a metronome. Oh, you were afraid I would say that. Fall in love with your metronome. If you are less than perfect in rhythm, that's not acceptable to the people around you or to you. So if we're supposed to play bump and 85 people put the note there and you put the note but there, the technical term for that is sloppy. And one person can make an ensemble sound sloppy. And you don't want to be that person. So if you hate the metronome, I would say to you, tough, get over it, do fall in love with it. It will make you more and more and more accurate. You need one that's loud enough that you can't ignore it. I'm not altogether convinced that phone metronomes work because they're so quiet. You can tune them out, but you can get a nice annoying little chirp, chirp, chirp metronome, or those things that in the band hall, bang, bang, those are great. Practice things slowly. do short sections and gradually increase length and increase tempo and do this early and every day. That is going to be very applicable to what we're doing here today. And the philosophically, the last thing about great technique is that practice is not repetition. You remember middle school? Yeah, Mom, I practiced. I played everything four times. That's not practice. Practice is repeated success. Now, I really have not met most of you guys, but I know that every last one of you prefers success to failure. Seems sensible to me. And so you want to play it perfectly as soon as possible. Don't say, well, I'll get this, I've got until November 3rd. You want to be successful, successful, successful. You'd like to get this aced by mid-September, every last one of these things. And then you're playing it well and playing it well and playing it well. And I'll let you in on a little secret. By the time we master, whether it's etudes for region band or solo and ensemble contest, we're kind of bored with the piece. That's okay. Great articulation. I'll have to do this if I get together with you individually because it takes a little too long and we've got a half hour to play with here. So the syllable method, ta, tu, da, da. Think spit. You could practice little spit balls in a wastebasket at home. There's your motion for articulation. You want to practice slow to fast with a metronome. You want to practice few to many with a metronome. You do not want to overpower your reed, so be aware of that. Sometimes if you feel like you are, tuck in a little of the top lip too. If you're biting too hard, it'll hurt and you won't do it. You want to practice the end of a phrase. Ta, then ta-ta, then ta-ta-ta, then ta-ta-ta-ta, then ta-ta-ta-ta. And at some point it'll break down and you start over again. That's also practice is repeated success. When you self-destruct, restart the entire procedure. We want an articulation here. If this is the tip of the reed, the tongue should come up like this. Not this, and not this, and certainly not this. So here's our reed. The tongue comes up, curves, and the tip of the tongue is very flexible, and so you want to block the opening. And when it's time to tongue that note, the tongue falls out of the way, and the wind that's trying to get through there does. Artistic phrasing. We'll use this today too. Growth, maturation, and fade. We're looking for the emotional high point of the phrase, which is not the highest note in the phrase, usually. But it's going to be late in the phrase on a strong beat. In the second etude, and strong beat is usually one, and in this case, David Haidt actually did the dynamics correctly, so that's nice. Later on in the piece, he did not, and that's determined by whether it's effective or not, and not just what he wrote. Maturation is late in the phrase on a strong beat, and then the rest of that note and the rest of that phrase is fade, winding down, losing interest. That's why it has to be late in the phrase, because we're losing interest and losing audience, and so then we want to be on to the next phrase. Scales, your old friend. You want to be working on scales every day of your life, whether you want to or not. Scales, whole tone scales, arpeggios, four note fragments, C, D, E, F, D, E, F, G, E, F, G, A, da, 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 so on. Scales in thirds, C, E, D, F, E, G, F, scales in fourths. You don't do them all every day, but you go through kind of a routine of polishing your playing in these exercises. Scales in combination with rhythms. Several other things here. I'm going to put this, I'll put my script here on camera for you to use. Take screenshots if you think that this is something that you'd like to adopt in your routine, but there isn't a lot of time to do all this today. Now, we all have four levels of playing. The first is, I can do this. So, you're in high school, you're pretty good players. And for whatever reason, you find yourself back at the middle school where you started playing. And the band director, who's a friend of yours, is in panic because tonight's the concert and the little first chair player, the only one capable of playing that solo, has broken a finger that day. There's nobody else in the section capable of doing that. And so the person asks you, as a friend of the program, will you please come in and play sight read the concert? And you will, of course, do it, and you will sight read it better than that little varmint could have played it after 3 months of prep, because you're a vastly more advanced player than that. It's not close. So that's, I can do this. I can learn this. Here we are, region etudes. They're a struggle, they're a challenge, but you are capable of learning them. We don't like to admit the third one, I can fake this. We don't admit it in public anyway. And the fourth, I can't do this. And the story of our progress is as players is moving out of categories 3 and 4, I can fake this and I can't do this, into categories 1 and 2, I can do this and I can learn this. We should push finger busters, that's little nasty technical exercises, until we can't even give the right impression anymore. So we move beyond, I can fake this. So we've got exercises like that, and every one of them should end in failure. It's really quite a concept, but we push failure as far down the road as we can. And keep score when you do those kinds of things. Technical passages in our music, yes, we'll be doing something with those. A couple of additional tips. Early in the process, train yourself about staccatos, and especially staccatos under slurs. But staccato always includes sound and silence. Use the silence to get your fingers ready for the next note. So there's that split second, and it's as confusing as can be for the first day or two that you try and do this. And then you say, how did I ever play without doing that? Okay. Region etude number 1, rows 40, etude, 40 studies. This is number 36 in C major. I'll read this, and again, we'll make it available to you after. Before we start, you'd like to have 2 to 3 clean copies of each of these etudes.